Well, it's great to be here with everyone today. My message is simple and straightforward. There is one thing that is common to every individual, relationship, team, family, organization, nation, economy, and even civilization throughout the world. One thing which, if you remove, will destroy the most powerful government, the most successful business, the most thriving economy, the most influential leadership, the greatest relationship, the strongest character, the deepest love. On the other hand, if developed and leveraged, that one thing has the potential to create unparalleled success and prosperity in every dimension of life. Yet, it's the least understood, most neglected, most underestimated possibility of our times. That one thing is trust. The one thing that changes everything. Now, I first learned about trust when I was a young 7-year-old boy. How many of you are familiar with my father's book, The 7 Habits of Highly Effective People? Okay, quite a few. Well, do you remember in that book where my dad told the story of trying to teach his son how to take care of the yard? He called it green and clean. Well, folks, I'm that green and clean kid. And I came here today to give you my side of the story. For those that aren't familiar, let me recount this. So, this is how it happened. I was just a young boy, 7 years old. My father was trying to teach me responsibility, trying to teach me to know how to take care of the yard. So he said, son, I have two key things I want for this yard. And they're results words. I want it to be green, and I want it to be clean. And then he said, now look, green is the color of our neighbor's yard. Because our yard was kind of yellow when he was taking care of it. And that's what we want, is that green color. And here's how you do it. This is before the day of automatic sprinklers. We had three sides of parts of the yard. You have to go out and manually turn them on every day. It's the middle of the summer. That's what we want, green. And here's what clean means. And there was, you know, the yard was there, and there was some garbage thrown. He went and picked up half of it, left the other half. Look, that side's clean, that side's not. You got it, son? Yeah, got it, Dad, got it. I'm clear. Well, he trained me every day for 2 weeks to take this big job on, to make sure the yard was green and clean. Then he turned over the job to me after 2 weeks. Okay, son, it's yours. This is on a Friday. So Friday goes by, and I do nothing. Saturday goes by, do nothing. Sunday, nothing. Monday, nothing. Tuesday, nothing. And by the way, this is in the middle of the summer. It's scorching hot, and the lawn is withering up by the day and yellowing. On a Wednesday, he comes home from work, and he looks at the lawn, and it's yellow and messy. There, we had a neighborhood barbecue over the weekend. There was garbage thrown everywhere. And he got out of the car. He sees me across the street playing in the park. And he said he just wanted to kind of just take that job right back and just go do it himself. But he didn't. Bit his tongue. Went into the house. I came home a little bit later, and he said, son, why don't we walk around the yard like we had agreed we'd do once a week just to see how things are going? And I kind of sheepishly said, okay. And then we started walking around together, and I was looking down at the yard, and you know what? It's not green and clean. It's yellow and messy and unkept. Garbage everywhere. And as we're walking around, I suddenly begin to quiver, break down, and began to cry. And I said to my dad, oh, Dad, this is just so hard. And he said, what's hard, son? You haven't done one thing. But here's what was hard. What was hard was me learning responsibility, me taking initiative, me taking over that agreement he'd given me. And I said, well, will you help me out? He said, what was our agreement? I said that you said that you would help me when you have time. That's right. Do you have time, Dad? I've got time. So I ran into the house, brought out two garbage sacks. I took one, gave him one. And then I said, hey, Dad, would you mind going over there and picking up that garbage? Because it makes me want to vomit. He said, son, I'm your helper. I'll do whatever you want. And now he's following my direction. I'm leading him, and he's helping me out. It was at that moment that I took on that responsibility. It was at that moment that I became green and clean. That agreement that we had worked on for 2 weeks became written in my heart. Now, my father, we used to use this in Seven Habits to talk about win-win performance agreements or stewardship delegation. But you know what? I was a seven-year-old boy. I didn't know what those things meant. But here's what I knew as a seven-year-old. It was simply this. I felt trusted. I felt my father trusted me, and I didn't want to let him down. Look, I was too young to be worried about money or status, but I didn't want to let my dad down, and I felt it. I might not have described it in terms of the words of trust, but it's what I felt. He trusted me. It inspired me. It brought out the best in me. I rose to the occasion. I took over that job, not only that summer, but from that point on. To be trusted is the most compelling form of human motivation. In fact, let me rephrase that. To be trusted is the most inspiring form of human motivation. And it's what we need today in a low-trust world. But look at the nature of the world today. It's increasingly interdependent, collaborative, a knowledge worker age. And knowledge workers don't want to be managed. They want to be led. They want to be inspired. They want to be trusted. And those that operate under the old model of command and control, instead of trust and inspire, that's analogous to playing tennis with a golf club. The tool is not suited for the new reality. And the reality is that trust is what's needed in a knowledge worker interdependent age. Now, we all kind of intuitively know this. In fact, I'd like to do a little exercise with every one of us here. As you're seated, I'd like you to identify a person that you work with and with whom you have a high trust relationship. So think of someone that you work with that you trust. You trust them, they trust you. So it could be a boss or a colleague or a peer, direct report, partner. And let me ask you this question. And as I ask you a couple of questions, actually, as I ask you these questions, just kind of capture, mentally note, or maybe write down the first impressions that pop into your head, first thoughts that come to you. So what is it like to work with this person who you trust? What's it like to work with him or her? What's it like to communicate with this person? How fast can you get things done? What kind of results are you able to achieve? All right, now I'd like you to identify a second person. So this time identify someone that you work with and that you need to work with, but in this case, with whom you have, for whatever reason, a low trust relationship. So what's it like to work with this person who you don't trust? What's it like to work with him or her? Capture it. What's it like to communicate with this person? How long does it take to get anything done? What kind of results are you able to achieve? All right. Now contrast that. Compare and contrast these two relationships. I think we all get it instantly. Trust changes everything. And not in small incremental ways, but in profound ways. So I've got three main points that I'd like to highlight about trust, three big ideas. And one, the first is a business case for trust. The second is a leadership case for trust. And the third is to show how trust is a learnable skill, a competency. So let me describe each. First, the first big idea is that trust is an economic driver, not merely a social virtue. Let me put this another way. There is a business case for trust, and it's a compelling case, and I'll make it in just a moment. Trust is financial, not just social. You can put a value on it. So here's a kind of a very simple way of expressing a powerful and profound formula, an expression. Trust always affects two measurable outcomes, always. They are speed and cost, and here's the formula. When the trust goes down in a relationship, or on a team, in a culture, in a company, in any situation, when the trust goes down, you will find that the speed goes down with it. Everything will take you longer to do, and the cost goes up. Everything will cost you more to do. Now, this is a tax, a low trust tax, and the examples are all around us. Think of any situation, relationship, team, where there's low trust. It takes you longer, costs you more. But here's the good news. The good news is the dividend is equally real. And when the trust goes up in the relationship, on the team, in the culture, when the trust goes up, the speed goes up with it. Everything happens faster, and the cost comes down. Everything costs us less. This is a dividend, a high trust dividend. My friends, it is that simple, that real, that predictable, and it's playing out everywhere. Just think of the high trust relationship you identified a few minutes ago. My guess is you move fast, low cost. Think of teams you've been a part of, where there's high trust on the team, the speed at which you can move. Think when there's groups and parties and teams that need to work together and collaborate, and they trust each other. See, speed happens when people trust each other. A business example, I was with Grady Rozier of McLane Food Services. His company was acquired by Warren Buffett several years ago. $23 billion business. So this is not a little deal, big deal. Here's how the deal happened. Buffett wrote, to make the McLane deal, we had one single meeting of about 2 hours. We then shook hands. 29 days later, they had their money. We did no due diligence. We knew everything would be exactly the way they said it would be, and it was. Now here's a mega deal happening in less than a month with no due diligence. I used to work for a short stint in investment banking. And I can tell you that a deal of that size would typically take you 6 months to close. And typically you spend millions in due diligence. But in this particular case, high trust, you know, Grady Rozier, of him that said that he will do what he says he's going to do. High trust, they come in, do a deal in a simple handshake, close it in less than 1 month instead of 6 months to a year, spend no money in due diligence instead of the millions typically spent. Now that is what I mean by the speed of trust. You can't do a deal like that without trust, or it'd be foolish to try. But with trust, it becomes a possibility. Nothing is as fast as the speed of trust. And the data on this is overwhelming. A Watson Wyatt study shows this, that high trust organizations outperform low trust organizations by three times, 286%. It's a multiplier, it's economic. Here's the second big idea. The second big idea is the leadership case for trust. And it's showing that trust is the number one competency of leadership needed today, more than any other. That's a bold statement to make, because there's a lot of important competencies to have as a leader. I know that, you know that. But I'm saying that trust is the number one competency because it will make you better at every other competency that you need to have. All of the things you need to do, you can do better if you start with trust. So what are those other things you need to do as a leader? Think about it. We need to collaborate, to partner, to team. It's hard to collaborate with people who you don't trust. Now, you can coordinate with them, but there's a big difference, isn't there, between mere coordination and true collaboration. It's trust that turns a group of people into a team. It's trust that turns a supplier or a vendor into a partner. Trust is transformative to the relationship. How about attracting people and retaining people? Nothing attracts and retains people like a high-trust team, a high-trust culture. Nothing repels people like a low-trust culture. It changes everything. How about innovation? So vital today. Innovation flourishes when there's a collision of differences in an environment of trust. When there's low trust, it's hard to sustain innovation for an organization, for a society. Leading change, again, happens best with trust. Sales, people buy from those that they trust. Execution, do it faster with trust. Everything you need to do, you can do better if you start with trust. It's high leveraged. The one thing that truly changes everything as a leader. I told you on the business case, the quantitative side, that it's about speed and cost. Well, on this leadership case, the qualitative side, it's about energy and joy. And here's the formula. When the trust goes down in the relationship, on the team, in the culture, when the trust goes down, you'll find that the energy in all its forms will go down with it, as will the joy in all its forms. So what do I mean by energy? Well, actual physical energy. Nothing is as exhausting as low trust. But emotional energy as well, that's passion. Creative energy, that's innovation. Organizational energy, that's engagement. They'll all go down when the trust goes down. As will joy. What is joy? To an individual, you'd call it happiness. On a team, you'd call it fun. And in an organization, you'd measure it as satisfaction. They'll all go down when the trust goes down. But the good news is that the converse is equally real. And when the trust goes up, in the relationship, on the team, in the culture, the energy in all its forms goes up with it, including the passion people feel, their creativity, the innovation, the engagement, as will the joy, the happiness, the satisfaction, the fun. Nothing engages people like being trusted, and nothing inspires people like being trusted. Think of yourself as Exhibit A, when you're trusted compared to when you're not. The difference qualitatively in what that does. That's the leadership case for trust. Now, The third big idea is that trust is a learnable competency. It's a skill. It's something we can learn and do and get better at and move the needle at. So I'd like to share a couple of things that we can do to build the trust and how we can grow it as a leader, but also as a team and as an organization. See, trust is a function of two things. It's a function of our credibility and our behavior. Credibility and behavior. Let me take credibility first. Credibility is the foundation on which all trust is built. In the long run, we'll never have more trust than we have credibility. So imagine there's a legal case going on, a court of law. And in this case, there's no physical evidence, no tangible evidence. It's all coming down to the contradictory testimony of two witnesses, where one witness is saying one thing and the other witness is saying just the opposite. In a situation like that, what is that case going to hinge upon? Which witness is more credible? And one side will try to build up the credibility of their witness. The other side will try to tear it down. They might say, look, this person's not honest, or they have an agenda, or they're not qualified, or look at their track record. You can't count on it. The other side will try to build it up in those same ways. I just gave four ways that you can tear it down or build it up. Let me label that. I'll give you a metaphor to do it. That of a tree. You got the roots and the trunk of the tree. See, that is like character. Vital, but by itself is insufficient, like a tree stump. Then you have the upper half of the tree, the branches and the fruits. That's like competence. Vital, but by itself insufficient, like a tree without roots. What we're looking for, of course, is that combination of both the character and the competence. And when you have both, that is the basis for sustainable trust. So there are what I call four cores, or four dimensions of credibility, two of which belong to character, and two of which belong to competence. These four cores are really a deeper dive into the character and competence idea. So let me describe them briefly. The roots of the tree, the first core, is integrity. That's honesty, it's truthfulness, doing the right thing. I think we get this one intuitively. But the next core is also vital, and that is the trunk of the tree. It's what we call intent. And intent is referring to our motive and to our agenda. The motive that best builds credibility and trust is when we care about the people that we're serving and they know we care about them. The agenda that best builds credibility and trust is when we seek mutual benefit. That's called win-win. Yes, I want to win. Of course I do, but I want your win as much as I do my own. Then we move into the competence side. The third core of credibility is capabilities. It's the branches of the tree. See, it's those branches that produce the fruits. And capabilities are referring to our talents and our skills and our expertise and our knowledge. If you can move the slide forward, it's not moving. Our knowledge, that's capabilities. And the key question here is, are you relevant? Are you relevant? Are you learning, growing, improving, getting better, staying relevant? If you are, you'll tend to be trusted. But if you're not, you'll have a hard time sustaining that trust. And the fourth core of credibility are the fruits of the tree. And I call it results. And by results, I mean your performance, your current performance, your past performance. Why does that matter? Because people do project upon you future performance based upon what they've seen. When they see a track record of results, it gives them confidence. But if there's a gap in those results, there'll be a gap in that confidence. So our performance matters in the building of trust. Look at that. Integrity and intent flowing from our character. Capabilities and results flowing from our competence. These help us build trust. This combination, credibility for a leader, for a team, for an organization, these four things. Now, I said there was another key thing. It was about credibility, and it was about behavior. If you can go back one. Credibility and behavior. So let me describe what I mean by behavior. By behavior, I mean what we do and how we do it. It's not enough just to talk about it. We got to put it into action. We got to put it into practice. We have an expression where we say this: you can't talk yourself out of a problem that you behave yourself into. Now think about that. If we've lost people's trust through our behavior, the only way to get it back is through our behavior. We got to behave our way back into trust. And not all behavior is created equally. Some matters more than others. Well, we've identified the highest leverage behaviors that build trust. From the hundreds, there's 13 that are extremely highly leveraged. Behaviors like talk straight, demonstrate respect, create transparency, right wrongs, show loyalty, deliver results, get better, confront reality, clarify expectations, practice accountability. Now listen carefully to these last three. Listen first. Keep commitments and extend trust. Let me take that last one, extend trust. Such a powerful behavior that builds trust. Why? It's what my father did with me when I was young. It's what we can do with others. Think of people that have trusted you in your life and what you did with that trust, how it inspired you. Here's what trust does, what being trusted does. We rise to the occasion. We perform better. We develop new skills and capabilities. And guess what else? We reciprocate the trust. We give it back. One of the best ways to create trust is simply to give it. That's what leaders do. The first job of a leader is to inspire trust. And the second job is to extend it, is to give it. Why? Because you'll generate a reciprocity. When you withhold it, they withhold it. I've worked all around the world with organizations. I found the number one reason why employees don't trust their management is because the management doesn't trust the employees, and the employees reciprocate that distrust right back at them. Same thing can happen with partners, even with customers. There's a reciprocity to trust. As a leader, lead out with trust. Extend it. And it's the job of the leader to go first. Someone needs to go first. That's what leaders do. Leaders go first. Yeah, there's a risk in trusting, but there's also a risk in not trusting. And I'm going to suggest in today's collaborative, interdependent world that not trusting is more often the greater risk. So be smart about it, but lead out in extending trust to others. So credibility, behavior, and the extension of trust. Now, sometimes the challenge is to restore it because it's been lost. Can you restore it? Yes. Is it easy? No. Does it happen all the time? No. You've got to be careful. But how do you do it? Through your behavior. So let me tell you a story. I started with my father and me. Let me end with my son and me. So a couple years ago, my son turned 16. He's excited to drive. My wife and I sit down with him. Hey, driving's a privilege, not a right. Let's go over the rules. Be safe. Go to the speed limit. Wear your seatbelts. Obey the laws. You got it, son? Yeah, got it, Dad. Got it, Mom. Are you clear on these rules? Because if you violate these rules, you're going to lose the privilege to drive. Don't worry, he said. Well, everything was great for the first month. And I'll never forget, about a month into it, it was a Friday night at midnight. I hear the phone ring. My wife, his mother, answers the phone. I hear her say these words. Well, I'll let you talk to his father, officer. And sure enough, it's the police. My son has been pulled over for speeding, excessive speeding, as in going 83 miles an hour in a 25 mile an hour zone. Now, he's a good kid. He just had teenage judgment. Well, the judge fined him $555. We made him pay it, took away all of his savings from his summer job. But then to our surprise, the judge did not suspend his license, did not. So guess who did? That's right, we did, Mom and Dad. Why? Because we wanted him to trust us. And we felt like if we didn't hold him accountable to what we mutually agreed to, he wouldn't trust us. Neither would his siblings. Oh, that was hard on him. He was embarrassed with his friends. It was hard on all of us. But after several months, he came back to me and said, Dad, I'm ready to drive again. I asked, are you clear about the rules? He replied, I've never been more clear about anything in my life. Well, it's had a great ending. He's been a model driver ever since. How do we know? Well, we see it, we observe it, but we also hear from his friends' parents. When they're going somewhere, they might hear, hey, where are you going? And they'll say, hey, don't worry, Mom. Don't worry, Dad. We're going with Covey. And that means we are driving way below the speed limit. You know, we're wearing seatbelts. I mean, this is no fun at all. But he has earned that reputation. You see, he has behaved himself out of the problem that he behaved himself into. And today, the trust isn't only back to where it was, it's actually higher than it ever was. You can restore trust in most situations through your behavior. My friends, I've made three main points. First, there's a business case for trust. It's about speed and cost. Second, there's a leadership case for trust. It's about energy and joy. Third, trust is learnable. It's about credibility and behavior, especially the behavior of leading out and extending trust to others. Nothing is as fast as the speed of trust. Nothing is as profitable as the economics of trust. And nothing is as inspiring as an offering of trust. It's truly the one thing that changes everything. And in the words of Albert Schweitzer, he said, in everybody's life, at some time, our inner fire goes out. It is then burst into flame by an encounter with another human being. We should all be thankful for those people who rekindle the inner spirit. when we extend trust to another person, we rekindle the inner spirit, both theirs and ours. And in so doing, we can also produce an extraordinary dividend, what I call the speed of trust. Thank you so much, my friends. Really honored to be with you.